This PowerPoint covers chemical bonding and nomenclature, part of Chapter 3 and most of Chapter 4 in your textbook. Here is an overview of the topics we'll be discussing: properties of ionic and covalent compounds, electronegativity and bond polarity, naming and formula writing, polyatomic ions, naming and formula writing for covalence, dot structures, as well as molecular shape and polarity. Let's start by discussing some common properties of compounds. Ionic compounds are composed of metals and nonmetals. They have what is known as a crystalline structure, which means that they have a regular repeating pattern. So they go NaCl, NaCl, NaCl. The smallest piece for an ionic compound is a formula unit. That's going to be important later. And they are strongly bonded because opposites attract. So positive charges are attracted to negative charges. These are often referred to as electrostatic forces. They have a very rigid structure, which means they're brittle. For example, if you took one piece of salt and tried to bend it, it would definitely break. And they have high melting points because of their strong forces. Covalents, on the other hand, are only nonmetals. The smallest piece is called a molecule. They are going to share electrons. They can be polar or nonpolar. We are going to cover that in more detail later. For right now, polar means different, and nonpolar is going to mean the same. And they have much lower melting points. One thing I forgot for ionic compounds is that they transfer electrons. So please add that to your notes. A good example of an ionic compound would be something like NaCl. A good example of a covalent compound would be something like wax or sugar. Okay, or even something like methane, so you have an actual chemical formula. One of the things you're going to be expected to be able to do is to determine if something is ionic or covalent. We can do this by using the periodic table. Ionics are opposites. That's how I like to remember it. Covalents are close together. So an ionic has a metal and a nonmetal, usually opposite sides of the table. And covalents are only found in a certain section because they're only nonmetals. So what I would like you to do is pause the video and identify if each of the compounds over here should be ionic or covalent. Please check your answers. I have two that are starred that you may have gotten wrong. This here appears to be made of all nonmetals, and technically it is. But it's made of special ions called polyatomic ions that act like they have a positive or a negative charge. So the NH4 portion has a positive charge and the NO3 has a negative. So it's composed of ions, therefore it's ionic. We'll cover that in more detail a little later. And then the GeS2. Well, G is a semi-metal, so you might have been like, wait, what do I do? It's not a metal or a nonmetal. In general, our semi-metals act like nonmetals when they bond. Therefore, Ge is serving as a nonmetal, and S is also a nonmetal, so it's covalent. Let's talk about electronegativity. Electronegativity is actually another trend that's found on the periodic table. The trend is very similar to ionization energy. So if you look across here, the numbers increase. So we see an increase across the table, and we see a decrease down the table. Our noble gases don't have electronegativities, as you can see here. They're not listed because of what electronegativity is. Electronegativity is defined as the measure of how strongly an atom is attracted to an electron in a bond. And the noble gases, we know, already have 8 valence electrons or a full valence shell, and therefore they don't want electrons, so they don't have electronegativities. We can actually use this chart to make predictions on the type of bond something has, and we're going to practice that shortly. So the difference in electronegativity between two elements plays a major role in determining the type of bond that it most likely is. If the difference is between 0 and 0.4, we have what we're going to call nonpolar covalent. If the difference is between 0.5 and 1.9, this is known as polar covalent. Please feel free to abbreviate these NPC and PC. And anything greater than 2 is too large of a difference for the electrons to be shared. So these are just said to be ionic. And I usually just use an I for that. So let's do an example. If you were asked to tell me the bond polarity of Na and P, here's what you would do. You find Na, you find P, and you take the difference in their values. So Na was 1.0. P was 2.1. The difference between them is 1.1. Therefore, since it is 1.1, we would say that this is a polar covalent substance. Let's try a few. So Li and F, Al and Si, and C and N. Please pause the video and try identifying the bond type for these three. Hopefully, once you find the elements and you found the difference in electronegativity, you saw that LiF was ionic because it has a difference of 3.1. The AlSi has a difference of 0.3, so it's nonpolar covalent. And the C and the N have a difference of 0.6, so it would be polar covalent. On the test, the chart on this slide will be provided, but you will want to memorize these. Let's do a quick review of atoms and ions because it's been a little while since we've talked about them. Atoms are things that are electrically neutral, and the reason for that is because the protons equal the electrons. Ions are things that have a charge, and the reason for that is because the protons do not equal the electrons. We talked about positive ions, and we've talked about negative ions. But now we're going to give them additional names. So your cations are positively charged. These are going to be your metals. These are the substances that lose electrons. Your anions are negative ions. These are going to be your nonmetals, and these are going to gain electrons. Across the periodic table, there's a trend, and you're going to want to memorize these charges. Group 1A has a plus 1 charge. Group 2A has a plus 2. Group 3A has a plus 3. If it's bothering you that 4A doesn't have anything, you can put plus or minus 4. It's just not very common. And then after you get to positive 4, we're going to go backwards. So group 5A has a negative 3 charge. Group 6A has a negative 2, group 7A has a negative 1, and group 8A has a charge of 0. You'll notice here that the bulk of the transition metals do not have given charges, and that's because they vary. These elements are able to transition from one charge to another. There are a few that never change. Silver has a +1 charge, and then our zinc and cadmium are almost always +2. Let's talk about ionic bonding. Ionic bonding involves the transfer of one or more electrons from one atom to another. It is a positive and a negative ion, so usually it's a metal with a nonmetal. The cations and anions surround each other. They have an electrostatic attraction, opposites attract. And here the sodium is transferring its electron to chlorine. Sodium has one valence electron that it would like to get rid of so that it has a full outer shell. Chlorine has 7, so it needs one more to obtain that full valence shell. In the end, all electrons always have to be accounted for. So let's run through this example. Calcium is in group 2A, and we're going to run through some dot structures here that we'll learn about in a little while, so just kind of bear with me. So it gets two dots. Phosphorus is in group 5A, so it's going to have 5 valence electrons and get 5 dots. So the calcium is going to get rid of each of its dots. But then there's a leftover dot on the phosphorus. So a second calcium has to come in and share an electron, or excuse me, transfer an electron to the phosphorus. Well, now there's a leftover electron on calcium, so phosphorus comes back in, and that electron is transferred. Now this phosphorus has 2 available electrons, so it needs 2 more. So an additional calcium comes in to give up its electrons. In the end, when calcium and phosphorus combine, they form Ca3P2. We're going to talk about how to do that without drawing all of those diagrams. First, we're going to talk about how to name ions and ionic compounds, and then we'll talk about the formulas. So when I'm naming ions, when I'm doing cations, I'm going to write the name of the metal. So sodium is sodium. Iron is iron. Rubidium is rubidium. If it is a transition metal, so a D-block element, we have to indicate the charge of that particular element using Roman numerals in parentheses. The exceptions to this rule are, of course, zinc and silver. They never get a Roman numeral. And actually, 2 that are not transitional, which are lead and tin. So both lead and tin can actually be a +2 or a +4 charge. So because they have different options for charges, they require a Roman numeral. Let's go through and do some examples, and then you'll have a chance to try some. So Rb+1, you just look on the periodic table, and you would see that that's rubidium. It's not transitional, so it does not need a Roman numeral. Fe is iron, but it is a transition metal, so it would require the Roman numeral 3. And lead is one of the exceptions above. So even though it's not transitional, it still needs a Roman numeral. So this would be lead 4. Please pause the video and either name the ions or provide the ion. Please check your answers. Remember, not all elements get a Roman numeral. And then when you're writing the ion, you have to look at where it's located on the periodic table to determine its charge, or use the provided Roman numeral to determine its charge. We will continue our study in the next video.